You're listening to the Under the Ring Report, a weekly podcast that asks the question, why pro wrestling? Here's your host, John the Flesh Wound.
And welcome, wrestling fans, to episode 10 of the Under the Ring Report. Thanks a lot for downloading and taking a listen. This week, we're going to go back to March of 2000, where I had the pleasure to talk to WWE Hall of Famer Harley Race. Here's that interview with Harley Race.
Well, thank you. It's always a pleasure to talk to the people.
First thing I want to ask you is, how you got started in the business?
Well, I actually got started with Gus Karras in St. Joe, Missouri. He had a carnival that he took all over the Midwest. He was probably up in your area at one time or another. And at 14 years old, I was taking on all comers out of the crowd. And at 15, I broke in just strictly on the pro side, and I've been in it ever since, and I'm just about ready to turn 57.
What would you say is probably some of your most fondest memories?
Well, it'd have to be the first time I captured the world's title, and you were just telling me a few minutes ago about having Dory Funk Jr. Mm-hmm. not too long ago. Dory Jr. and Terry were the only two brothers ever to hold the world's title, and I'm the guy that took it from both brothers. I took it from Dory in 1973, and then again in 77 from Terry Funk in Toronto. And I held it off and on 8 times over a decade.
You know, and nowadays that's unheard of to hear a guy hold the title for more than 2 or 3 months.
Well, 2 or 3 days is crowded.
Your time in the NWA, I mean, you wrestled with a lot of great talent. You know, tell people a little bit about that time, because that was before we actually had, you know, the big federations with the World Wrestling Federation and WCW. There was more of a territory thing going on.
Yeah, that's back when wrestling was wrestling. The W was still in it. There was 29 different promotions throughout the United States and Canada. Then you went into Mexico, then all of your overseas stuff. I made 65 different trips between here and Japan, probably about half that many up and down the whole Pacific Rim. Then Australia, New Zealand, I was over there, roughly 30 times apiece, all over Europe. Through the Fez year, Fez went to Mexico. Mm-hmm. Then after Fez, I was the only one ever to go back to Mexico defending the title.
Well, you also owned a couple of the territories there for a while, right? Central States and something in St. Louis?
Well, Central States was a 5-state area with a 13-state television station market. And St. Louis was a city promoted and ran strictly by itself by the president of the National Wrestling Alliance, Sam Mushnick. And long about the late 70s, Central States bought in as partner with Sam Mushnick. And then after, I'd say about 80, Central States bought control of it. Me owning a quarter of the whole area, I became the largest single stockholder in St. Louis.
Mm-hmm. Now, how was that, too? I mean, wrestling and owning your own promotion.
Well, I could have nothing to do with the wrestling, with the promotional side of it, as long as I was champion.
Oh, really?
So it was just more like an investment for me during that period of time.
Okay. Now, the one thing I remember, too, is I used to live down in the St. Louis area. I remember watching you every Sunday on Wrestling at the Chase. Remember the TV program they had there on a local TV station?
Yes, they just did a story on wrestling at the Chase, and I was one of the features of it all along in the fall, and I guess it's aired about 3 different times now since then. Went all the way back to the old courtesan room, which was a big room in the Chase itself that you could see roughly 700 people, and they all wined and dined and were served dinner and, you know, the whole bit while we were wrestling in the ring. It kind of went back to the old medieval days, you know, when the gladiators were out performing in the Parthenon and then later on in the Colosseum in Rome as people dined and watched them.
Now, what year did you decide then to jump to the World Wrestling Federation?
Well, first off, when Vince came in, the World Wrestling Federation had always been part of the National Wrestling Alliance. They were not allowed to call their champion world champion. So that group had been with us for a number of years through Vince's father. And then when Vince's father was diagnosed with cancer and retired to Florida, Junior took over and started coming around to different parts of the country and just buying our television stations away from us. So by the time all that had taken place, you know, it was either just retire and get away from it or work for him. You know, mm-hmm. There wasn't a whole lot of other avenues left open to you. So I went up with Vince in 86.
Okay.
And along about the latter part of 88, I was wrestling Hogan in Nashville, and I dove through a table, and the table had a 5-inch steel band around it that I didn't see. Well, that caused some abdominal problems.
Mm-hmm.
Make a long story short, 7 surgeries later, I was virtually out of wrestling.
Well, I was going to ask you, too, is you had a chance to wrestle in WrestleMania when it was at the Pontiac Silverdome in front of 107,000 people. How was that?
You're the only person I've ever heard describe that place and get the actual number right.
Really?
Record-wise for the state, it was actually 93,000. The rest were comps and everything else. But it, you know, I guess it's no different than wrestling. I shouldn't say no different. Mm-hmm. Of course it is. But you know, I wrestled sold-out buildings throughout my lifetime a lot of times. It was a pretty good rush to walk out there. They drove us out there on golf carts. That was unique. And to know that you had made history there by drawing the largest indoor crowd for any sport. It was great.
Oh, I bet.
And being one of the top 3 featured matches was also great.
Mm-hmm. You know, all along people have been talking, well, wrestling, you know, well, it's one of those other sports. And to see you guys do this, I mean, was unheard of.
Well, that holds true today, really. NFL Monday Night Football was really screaming and ranting and raving about WWF and WCW being on at the same time that mm-hmm. they were going on. This is the national tradition, blah, 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 blah. Well, it blew football away since, and it still has right today, even though they tried to start earlier this year and did a lot of things. But it turned a lot of people's heads. The sad part about it now is, with all the garbage that they're doing out there, it may be turning heads back the other direction.
That's true. Yeah, I was going to kind of ask you what your feelings on today's wrestling is.
Well, out of a 3-hour show, I timed it the other night, there was about 36 minutes of actual wrestling in 3 hours. The rest of it was just garbage. You know?
Mm-hmm.
I don't like that, but evidently the people do.
Yeah.
They're selling out everywhere.
Well, you know, maybe that's, right now I guess that's what people are wanting to buy, and, you know, the ratings are pretty much apparent for all the people that are watching. Now, one thing I know, too, is that, you know, a lot of fans out there got a chance to see you last fall on WCW as you were the special guest announcer for a match between Bret Hart and Chris Benoit. How refreshing was that for you to see a match like that actually take place on TV where they were allowed to wrestle instead of, you know, gimmicks and all that?
Well, what was really nice about it was, well, it's kind of a twofold thing.
Yeah.
My answer is going to be to you. It was a privilege to go there as the special announcer for that, because I go back with the Hart family 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
I go back with Benoit since his very first match ever. To be a part of that in itself was a privilege. The match itself became that as it progressed. All of the wrestlers in the building that night were glued to a monitor somewhere. And when it was over and we all walked back to the back, every one of the wrestlers there showed their appreciation to those two guys for doing what they did. And the people in the building got into that match as a wrestling match a lot more so than they did. Well, it was the best thing on the card that night by far.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's what I was going to ask you, is how was their reaction, you know?
You mean the guys in Bret and Benoit?
No, actually, I'm talking about the crowd themselves.
Well,
yeah.
The crowd was into it all the way.
Mm-hmm.
They really, really appreciated the effort those two guys put out. And that's, I don't know if you know what I'm actually doing right now myself, but I've started World League Wrestling here, and that's what we're trying to do, is that style of wrestling. And I keep referring to it as putting the W back in wrestling. My guys go out there, and they have a match, and halfway through it, the people are not turning around and looking back to the back to see who's going to come running out to screw the thing up. My guys are competing. That is my belief. After all the hoop brawl and after all the other stuff kindness to, and everything does. Everything tends to go away after a while. You know, baseball was the hottest rated thing that there was through the 50s, the 60s, and then football came along, and then it kind of blew it away. And football still, every night except Monday night, is the thing to watch.
Uh-huh.
I have chosen to take the Walmart effect and start here in the central part of America, where I grew up and where I'm probably known as well as the governor. And we're actually running what we like to refer to as fundraisers. We're not coming into any given city to take the money all out of the city. Come in through the Booster Club, the Chamber of Commerce, or something along those lines. And when we leave, like right here in Eldon, for instance, their Booster Club was virtually bankrupt. And when we left, they had over $4,000 in the bank.
Well, see, that's the nice thing, is that your company is giving back to the community. Unlike, you know, the major two right now, it's what can you do for me right now and give me all your money. You guys are giving back to the community, plus you're entertaining them.
Every place that we have been so far, we've been invited back, and for the community, it has been a success. And the majority of them for myself has been halfway decent.
Now, have you had a chance to get in the ring at all? I know you had the problems back in 93 with the car, or 95 with the car accident, but been in the ring at all?
I've got more bionic parts right now than the original.
So that means you're worth, what, $12 million now? Or?
I got two braces and 12 pins and a left forearm, which has worked great over the years.
Mm-hmm.
Four metal screws to right knee, artificial hip on the right side, and now two pins and eight screws in my back. So there's very little that I do around the ring right now.
Well, and they say wrestling's fake.
Yeah.
Well, what about, I know for a while there you were doing some managing in WCW. That was probably back in 93 or something. You ever want to do that again, maybe get in the big two?
No, sir.
No? Wasn't something you enjoyed at all, huh?
Well, I enjoyed it while I was there. The getting there and getting back to your base and getting to the next place and getting back. Traveling around with Luger was fun.
Mm-hmm.
Luger was kind of a fun guy. Traveling around with Big Vader, Leon White, leaves a lot to be desired. I traveled, you know, for 40 years. Virtually, I traveled every mile by myself. I've been a person that kind of enjoyed my own company. Being trapped for hour upon hour in cars with some of these guys will make you want to just stop the car and jump out and run in front of a train.
Get to know a little bit too much about them, correct?
Yes.
Now, as we're talking about, you know, we talked about your World League Wrestling. Any plans maybe to make that a little bigger, you know, and maybe spread it out a few more states? I know, because right now you're saying you're covering mostly Missouri, Kansas, correct?
Well, so far, we've been in Kansas, we've been in Iowa,
mm-hmm.
Missouri.
Okay.
I don't want to get the cart ahead of the horse and say we're going to be all over the Midwest, but that's my overall dream, is to kind of put the thing back the way it used to be here.
Okay.
When we ran southern Wisconsin, all of Iowa, parts of Illinois, all of Missouri, all of Kansas. Parts of Nebraska, all of Iowa, down into the northern edge of Oklahoma.
Mm-hmm.
But that's what our TV station markets covered, and that's where we went. And eventually, that's what I'd like to do again. Whether we'll get there, I don't know.
Well,
I don't ever see us, you know, going on a nationwide thing. Now, at 57 years old, I have enough problems just getting to where we're going now.
Mm-hmm. Now, you know, with the fall in ratings of WCW and things like that, do you think maybe there is just kind of a backlash in some of that regular wrestling like that? And, you know, there has been more of a push towards the leagues like your own and some of the independents that are around here. People are enjoying more of the hometown wrestling because it's bringing more of that entertainment to them than they're getting on the TV.
The problem with WCW right now is they're letting WWF take the lead. Whatever WWF uses up and are tired of at the time, WCW brings in and tries to live along those lines, just change it around a little bit. For WCW, if they just take the initiative to bite the bullet, they're doing anyhow right now. You know, their ratings are not near as high as then. But if they just go ahead and bite the bullet, develop that talent in the power plant, which is the largest organization that's teaching kids, if they just go ahead and bite the bullet and bring some of those brand new guys out of there like they did when they brought Goldberg out, Goldberg was hot as a firecracker. And instead of waiting for something to happen with Vince and then try to get that talent to come in, I think they'd be right back up where they need to be.
So, I mean, they're just right now, it just seems like they're pushing a lot of the guys that have been around for a long time, and there's no one in the back going, hey, well, here's your next big star.
Well, they had a group that went up to Vince.
Mm-hmm. That's correct.
These guys had went up as high up the WCW ladder as they were going to go.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you get up there, when all those positions are filled with your Hogans, your Kevin Nashes, and that list goes on and on. If there's no room there, the only place that there is room for you is in the other organization that is letting that stuff happen. They took The Undertaker and Mick Foley. They take him and they'll give him a half a year off with pay to let somebody else come in. That's how The Rock got there.
Well, and you know what it seems like right now? It seems as though WCW is just kind of letting that young talent go, and they just go over to the World Wrestling Federation, become big stars. I mean, well, as you just said, you know, guys like Benoit, a guy who left earlier, like Chris Jericho, things like that. These guys are all big stars, and they could have been doing that in WCW.
Jericho is kind of a pain in the ass wherever he
really? One thing I want to ask you too is one last question before we let you go. In all your time wrestling, which nearly spanning four decades, who would you say are probably some of your greatest matches? I mean, some of the greatest people you've faced.
Well, you know, it's a given. The match that I consider the best I ever had is the first time I won the world's title. But the Funks, the Briscoes, the Bruisers, the Brodies, the O'Connors, the Ganyas, any of those guys, you know, it's be almost impossible to pick between them and say which, you know, which was the best, which is the best.
If you got anything out there you want to let the fans know that haven't seen you for a while?
Well, we're here in the central part of America, and they can pull up HarleyRace.com and take a look at everything that we're doing out here.
Now, you're also running a school there, too?
Yes, we are.
All righty. Well, we want to thank you for taking the time to chat with us and wish you all the luck.
Well, we appreciate it, and thank you very much.
No problem.
And that's going to do it for this week's episode. Thank you once again for joining us for the Under the Ring Report. If you haven't, make sure to follow us on Twitter. It'll keep you up to date on everything going on. It's UTRR Podcast. Check us out. Interact with us and be listening for your chance to call in and be a part of the Under the Ring Report. We want to talk to all wrestling fans out there and get their ideas of why they love professional wrestling. Once again, thank you for joining us for this week's episode of the Under the Ring Report.
This is Harley Race, and if you want to hear about wrestling and what's happening today, listen to Under the Ring.
Thanks for listening to the Under the Ring Report. Please visit undertheringreport.com and subscribe for free so you can listen every week to the Under the Ring Report.